Okay, good afternoon everyone, and welcome to our event today, which is entitled Switched On, Are Switching Sites a Sign of Healthy or Broken Markets? Just to introduce myself, I'm Richard Howard, I'm the Head of Energy and Environment here at Policy Exchange. I lead all of our work on energy and environment and related themes. And I'll be chairing today's event. And for any of you who, I think I recognise lots of faces around the room, but for anyone who doesn't know Policy Exchange, we're a think tank, obviously based close to the action in Westminster, and we do a lot of different policy work across lots of different areas, including economics, energy and environment, housing, and all sorts of things. Arts, culture, all sorts of different policy areas. We hold lots of events like this and produce policy reports. And that's basically what we do. But yeah, the focus of today's discussion, as the title suggests, is on switching sites, or switching generally, and consumers' interactions with markets. I think a lot of the discussion will be about the energy market, given some of the speakers who are sitting with me, but we'd also like to look at best practice from other non-energy markets and maybe how some ideas can be transferred between the best practice ideas around how to organise switching and how to regulate switching sites and how we can sort of take that best practice from different sectors and apply that thinking. Before we get underway, I'd just like to thank the sponsors of today's event, who are Citizens Advice and the UK Regulators Network, who are both really quite involved in helping me shape the discussion today, so thanks to them for being involved. So our interest in this, there's a central theme running through a lot of Policy Exchange's work over the last few years has been sort of how to get a better deal for consumers in many different markets, so that applies to energy and other markets as well. We've done a lot of work on regulation and competition, and I've always been quite interested in switching and how people switch, and also the different sort of actors operating within that space, including price comparison websites, but also other people who facilitate switching, including brokers. And there's all sorts of new people getting involved in this space, sort of app-based switching applications, things like Flipper and so on, and all that's really quite interesting. So sort of in general, it's quite an interesting space, and in principle, switching is a kind of good idea. You can shop around and you can get a better deal. And all of these switching sites or digital comparison tools, as the Competition and Markets Authority is referring to them, all these tools allow you to switch. They allow consumers to access information on the different products and services available in a much more, they make it much more readily accessible than if you had to go and individually identify the prices from lots of different providers. So they do provide a platform for people to switch far more easily, and that's great. And you can make some material savings by switching. So for example, in energy, currently you can save roughly £300 if you switch from a standard variable tariff to a fixed price deal through a switching site. So there are significant consumer gains to be had, and if you go into the theory behind all of this as well, there's even other factors that we need to consider. So by having lots of switching going on, in theory, that puts pressure on all suppliers to be more competitive in the way they do business. So the government and regulators have really pushed this through things like the Be an Energy Shopper campaign, the Power to Switch campaign. The government and Ofgem and other regulators have all been very much behind the idea of switching. During the coalition's time, this was a big plank of the policy and of how sort of help people get a better deal. So all that's kind of, there's a very positive story to say about switching and switching sites. But equally, lots of people raise questions about this. So I think it's also reasonable to consider that side of the story. So the fact that we have such a growth in switching, in switching sites rather, and so many, it's a very quite successful switching sites, is that a sign that there's really healthy competition going on in these markets, or actually is it a sign that some markets have become so dysfunctional and kind of difficult to navigate that people can't possibly navigate them on their own and they need the assistance of a switching site to go about switching? Those are sort of two intentionally kind of polarised views. But some people sort of lodged reasonable concerns about how switching sites operate. And within that, what you can see is that there are some people who switch all the time, and there are some people who very rarely switch. So it's reasonable to sort of have a discussion around the impacts of switching on all consumers. You know, I talked in a blog a few months ago about a tale of two markets. You've got a group of switchers, very active consumers who do switch, swap around, get a better deal, and the rump of the market, for example, in energy, 70% of people who haven't switched for quite a long time. And what you see in this segmentation of the market is the most active people tend to be sort of more more educated people, people on higher incomes, and the people in the non-switchers group are disproportionately likely to be vulnerable households, elderly people, less educated people, people on lower incomes. So there's a real polarization going on in some markets about who's switching and who's not switching. So another set of questions which I want people to talk through on the panel today is around how price comparison sites, digital comparison tools, how do these businesses operate? Specifically, how do they display information on the different deals available to the market? How can people interact with that information? To what extent can they customize that information? How clear are they about where they're taking a commission or not? And how can we be sure that they are acting in the best interest of consumers? Those are all sort of interesting things to talk around. There's some good examples of good practice with some of these price comparison websites and others less so. So are they actually acting in the consumer's interest? Can people trust them? How should they be regulated? Those are all sort of questions which we need to explore further. And sort of related to that, how open and honest do price comparison websites need to be about how they make money and where they make money? Some are quite transparent about that, others less so. And it's a lot of consumers, even those who use price comparison websites, don't really understand how price comparison websites make money and the fact that they take commission. So what does that look like? So these are all questions which are being thought about. There's been a fair amount of discussion of this within the Competition and Markets Authority review of the energy market. That's quite a few things about energy price comparison services. And there's now an ongoing CMA review of digital comparison tools, to use their phrase, looking across all sectors. So I think they're looking at insurance, flights, and a couple of other sectors. They're actually not looking at energy in that particular review. But this is an ongoing thing which will be looked at about how these sites should be regulated. At the moment, they're actually quite loosely regulated. There's not a lot of regulation. There's various codes of conduct, but a lot of those are voluntary schemes. So this is a space where there is relatively light touch regulation. And there's interesting questions within that about if you even did go as far as regulating them more heavily, how do you keep up with the innovation going on in this marketplace with things like Flipper coming to the fore, which is sort of had not necessarily been thought of a few years ago. So regulation is not necessarily even that easy. I'm joined by a great panel of speakers to discuss these questions. And we'll sort of hear from them in turn in a moment to give their take, and then have a bit of discussion and Q&A afterwards. But firstly, we'll hear from Amanda Milling, who's been the MP for Cannock Chase since 2015. And Amanda sits on the Business Energy and Industrial Strategy Committee, so she has a sort of direct remit over some of these matters. And also had before she became an MP, she had a career in market research and has a lot of experience in financial services. So actually, hoping she'll say a bit about how some of this works in financial markets. Secondly, we'll hear from Right Honourable Sir Ed Davey, former MP and former Secretary of State for Energy and Climate Change, who will be known to many in the room. I'm really interested, and it was great that Ed can make it here today, because he, from what I understand, you were actually involved in establishing some of Ofgem's remit in this space to regulate these PCWs in the first place. But now Ed has a role as chairman of Mongoose Energy, which is an energy supplier, essentially. So
Not yet.
Okay. Becoming an energy supplier, a community energy company. So actually kind of sees it from the other side as well. So I think that's really quite interesting. Thirdly, we'll hear from Gillian Cooper, who's the head of energy retail markets at Citizens Advice. And Citizens Advice, I think, have some interesting perspectives on this. You do a lot of thinking about policy and regulation, but also at the hard edge of people calling you up saying, oh, how can I get a better deal on my energy and so on. So that's really quite interesting. Next we'll hear from Richard Neudegg, who's the head of regulation at uSwitch, one of the price comparison websites. And lastly, from Will Hodson, who's the co-founder of The Big Deal, which is not a switching site as in the normal sense, but is a collective switching organisation, and hopefully will tell us a bit more about what that involves. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Amanda.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. It's interesting, the first question that was posed is whether switching sites are a sign of a broken market, because actually when I was sitting there, I was thinking, well, actually, it's a sign of a healthy market. Don't worry, it's not mine. And it's about being able to enable people to switch. And I think the engagement that we see amongst those people who are switching shows that once people are using the site, they go on to start to engage the market and start switching and looking for better deals. For me, the more worrying point in all of this is, as you've described it, the tale of kind of two markets, which is, one, you've got a group of people who are engaged in the market, but then huge numbers who are just not switching. And I suppose it's really about kind of thinking about, well, why is it the case? I remember a model I used to use in market research a lot, and I have in front of me again, because it applied to both energy and financial services. And I'm really pleased to see the team from BACS here today, because I did a lot of work with the then Payments Council looking at the same issue in the current account market and the introduction of the current account switching guarantee. Because in both instances you face the same problem. You know, is it about awareness? Is it people not being aware that they can switch? Is it about understanding, or is it about seeing what the benefits of switching are? And I just want to kind of go through each of these. There's increasing awareness that we can switch our products. We see that, you know, across financial services, that, you know, you look at just kind of car insurance, for instance, something that increasingly people get the idea that they get their renewal notice and they kind of look at it and go, does that look like it's gone up a lot? And there's kind of a figure where people go, that's gone up a lot and I will start to do something about it. But then there's about understanding, and I think this is one of the kind of real issues that's well reported in the energy market, and actually an issue that price comparison sites face, which is, do people understand the market sufficiently to even think that I am going to switch my energy provider? Because there's that fear factor, it's going to be really complex, I don't really understand how it works, all of these units, I'm just going to switch off, I can think of better things to do with my life. Now that's something that switching sites face as well. And so there's kind of this point which the switching sites need to deal with, which is trying to be able to cut through and make it as simple as possible for consumers to kind of get over that hurdle, let alone anything else. And on that, I was actually really pleased to hear about the My Data and the introduction of that, which will hopefully make it easier for consumers to kind of go through the process. There's also a point about the kind of the benefits. Now, some people have switched years ago, but I remember in the world of research, people saying to me, well, I switched my energy provider, but I didn't really feel that I got a better deal as a result of it. And that's kind of stuck in their minds, and they've really not got over that. So kind of that kind of price reality, did it really come to fruition? And there was also the experience, in terms of, God, it takes a long time. And this is where the comparisons between current accounts and energy come into play. Because one of the things that came through with the current account switching guarantee was, you can switch within 7 days. And we are going to make it easy. And there were lots of things which were put into place where the industry worked together to make it a standard which worked across all energy providers. So I think kind of consumers are kind of really weighing up whether or not they feel that is it really worthwhile? Is it worth it financially? And is it worth it in terms of the amount of time and energy it's going to take? And actually, have I got the knowledge to even get to a price comparison website? But there's also the point which we're focusing on the price comparison website, but there's a lot of people who will not use a price comparison website. And actually, we need to be looking at ways that how do we engage those audiences. And when I was doing research in the energy market, I remember it was like, well, at what points in time do people kind of sit up and think about it? And there aren't that many touch points. For as long as I'm switching on the lights, the heating's coming on, I'm not really thinking about it that much. Think about it when I get a bill through the door, or and particularly if I get a bill where I kind of go, that's a shocker, does that really look right? Maybe my annual summary, you've actually got to get me to sit down and have a think about it. But the one time that we found was when it was in the news. So I remember around that time, it was like there were a lot of articles about kind of price rises. And that was the time when actually everyone was kind of sitting up and thinking. But actually it was also kind of driving this kind of there's a bit of a split on trust, because I know that that one of the reasons why people stay with their existing providers is because they trust them. Which actually this kind of media noise sometimes will make them say, well, should I really trust them? But that is a kind of key touch point when it's in the news. And so for instance, the league tables which have been announced, again, that will drive media attention in terms of what kind of deals are out there. And that's when people will sit up and think about switching their energy providers. So actually I think a lot of the discussion needs to be about this bigger group of people who are not switching at the moment, and how do we even get it on their radar? And that's where I would say there have been a lot of campaigns, you referenced the campaigns at the outset, and I think this applies to the switching sites as well, which is consistent campaigns. And actually this is where I do go back to the current account switching guarantee. Same with direct debit. It's something it's consistent, people start to recognise it, because it takes time. So I think with the accreditation of the sites, it's about kind of raising awareness amongst the public in terms of accreditation, and what does that really mean? So I think some of this is about kind of regulation of the sites, but actually for me, there are a lot more questions about kind of switching per se.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It's nice to get to know you, Amanda. Knowing that Theresa May worked for the Payments Council before she became an MP, you'll be someone to watch. I should declare some interest. I'm chairman of Mongoose Energy, which is a community energy cooperative, which will be launching a supply business later this year in an interesting format. I'm also an advisor to a large company that's launching a retail business later on this year. So in my life after office, I'm certainly very much involved in the market and debating energy policy. The basic question, are switching sites a good thing? Yes, they are, absolutely. While there are concerns, which Amanda's set out, and I'll come to myself in a second, basically they have been, I think, driving competition and driving a better value for consumers. Let me just take people back to what the alternatives might be. Well, one alternative would be to have a more nationalised system with very highly regulated, and you might think this is very unlikely. Well, when I was Secretary of State, I went to Prime Minister's Question Time, and the Prime Minister from the dispatch box said that there was going to be a new regulation which would force energy suppliers to put people on the lowest possible tariff. I went back to the department and the phones were off the wall as people said, are you re-regulating the whole sector? And I spent the next week digging Mr. Cameron out of the hole that he tried to get himself in. So there is political pressure even from the Conservatives on this area. And I note we've had noises off before Theresa May's Conservative Party conference speech that she was going to announce some sort of regulation. We saw that in the autumn statement. They're keeping a watch on the market. So clearly there is still political pressure to take a different approach. I think that would be a huge mistake for many reasons. There are, however, it's not the only way to drive competition and choice for consumers through switching sites. There are other mechanisms, of course. Back a decade or so ago, we had door-to-door selling. A huge success, and CAB and other people were rightly criticised. It still has a role to play, but we all know that door-to-door selling might result in bad outcomes. Indeed, as an MP for all that period, I dealt with a lot of vulnerable people who were treated very badly through door-to-door selling. All the evidence was the door-to-door selling did not result in many of the people who switched getting better deals. Some clearly did, but not all. When I became Secretary of State, I pushed collective switching, so I'm really looking to hear from the big deal. And one of the reasons I pushed collective switching is I thought through a trusted third party, you'd be able to take in more people who wouldn't otherwise engage in the market. And so collective switching was one way of having another different type of intermediary in the market beyond switching sites. I also set up something called the Big Energy Saving Network in December 2013 with the help of Citizens Advice Bureau and other community groups who now provide face-to-face advice services to vulnerable people to help them think through those issues. And I think growing that network is something that's really important if we're going to keep this basic competitive model, which I think's the right thing to do. There are other ways we could think about this as well. You mentioned My Data. I was actually Consumer Affairs Minister who sort of started that project off in my time at Biz, and I think that's got some way to go and would help. And we could look at other intermediary models which would help and would be an addition to switching sites. But the focus of the debate is on switching sites, so let's turn to the issues around switching sites. The big issue is there are people who don't engage. And this was a huge concern, one of the reasons we did the Big Energy Saving Network and collective switching. It's one of the reasons why fuel poverty policy is really, really important. Tackling that through energy efficiency, through support for people on low incomes, whether it's through a warm home discount or a reformed, I hope, winter fuel payment system. There are lots of things one needs to do to tackle fuel poverty because the market won't deliver everything that we want in energy policy. But I still think we need to think about why the market isn't delivering as well and for such an essential good for some people. And I think we need to address particular parts of the market. When the CMA review was announced and I supported that, I did write to them and said that they ought to look at the domestic gas retail market, because when you look at different parts of the market, that is one of the areas where there's a lot more sticky customers. Not in so much of the market, but in that end market, it's a lot more stickiness. And I also suggested they looked at new business models. Unfortunately, they did neither. I shouldn't complain, because I set up the CMA when I was at Biz as an independent body and not to take account of politicians, so, you know, that's probably my fault. But nevertheless, I think they should have done, and I hope indeed one day people will look at those two issues, because I think they remain important for some of the failings in the market. Moving on, though, I think is the question, how do you manage some of these problems? Clearly, regulation is part of the answer. While people worry about regulation, I was very proud in the Energy Act 2013, which I put through Parliament in section 143, which I'm sure you're all familiar with, to introduce to Ofgem within its jurisdiction the right to be able to regulate third-party intermediaries, including switching sites. And the question therefore is, now we've given our independent energy regulator that power, how is it using that power, how should it use it? And this is maybe getting some of the controversial issues, just to spark a bit of controversy. One of the big issues, of course, is should these switching sites have to have all the tariffs in the market on them or not? And there's a big debate about this. I start from a presumption that they should. I mean, there'll be arguments about whether that works or not, but I think one has to start from the presumption that the consumer looking at a switching website is going to assume that all the tariffs are there. And if we're into protecting the consumer, we should see the regulation of consumer enabling technology from the consumer's point of view. There are other issues about disclosures of commissions and so on. I think they're a bit more tricky, a bit less easy to argue for a lot of reasons, but I think one ought to start from the basis of transparency. And I think that is where I would like to see things go. If you then say, are there any other issues we could look at to improve performance in this area? Some people have argued for professional standards to be introduced. That's quite a step. It certainly might be something, particularly if you saw more new entrants into the market. We've obviously got two big players and smaller players. I'm not sure people saying they don't meet professional standards, but you might want to look at that. I think the thing that I would like to do, though, going back to the points around collective switching and big energy saving network, is to promote competition in all forms of ways in which consumers can engage in the market. And I think if we limit the debate to switching websites, that would be a very big mistake. Indeed, I go so far with respect to vulnerable consumers, and the most vulnerable consumers here, that we need to find a way to support sustainably things like the Big Energy Saving Network. And while we taxpayer funded that, and I believe that's still the case for the moment, is there a case for finding some way through the industry of a payment to make sure the Big Energy Saving Network could continue and was on a sustainable long-term footing, and indeed could grow? Because there will be some consumers that, without face-to-face advice from someone who's independent, from someone who's trusted, from someone who's trained, and that's where the costs actually come in, they're never going to switch. And I think we should be worried about those people. And if we want to make sure we're not having spending more and more on subsidies through things like the winter fuel payment, etc., actually we can get a lot of savings for the most vulnerable through supporting systems like the Big Energy Saving Network. So that, I think, really, really has to grow. I think I'm going to leave it there with one exception. I wanted just to come ahead of what we're going to hear from Will on collective switching. When we seed-funded collective switching back in 2013, and you saw a lot of local authorities engaged and then some other groups come in, the early signs were that it was reaching out to the fuel poor, to the less engaged. And indeed, the money that we put aside to support local authorities who were developing collective switching, the only constraint we put on them was that they had to show they were going to reach out to the fuel poor. However, while that movement developed, particularly after the retail market review, when the only type of tariff that didn't have to go along to the four core tariffs of the RMR was a collective switching tariff, so everyone went to collective switching. It really grew partly because of that regulatory change. We have seen, as collective switching has developed, it becoming actually less for the disengaged. I think the big six have got in there. I think they have been were using it almost as a predatory pricing, very sort of, if I can say it, dodgy, but here we are, just said it. Clearly, with the CMA moving back from the retail market review, which I think is right, there should be more than four tariffs, but that's less of an issue. But nevertheless, there still remains issues about how what tariffs are should be allowed. I'm particularly thinking about acquisition tariffs, which are exclusive to new customers. I think there has to be a real question about that in the wider regulation of the market. I think if we can look at that, then I think intermediary market-based mechanisms like collective switching could play a bigger role to help the less engaged and the more vulnerable.
Excellent points. To Jane.
This is a, so switching sites and the role of third-party intermediaries is a role of significant interest for Citizens Advice. We've published a lot of research on the energy market and other markets over the years. And in another life, we used to run the confidence code for energy switching sites, which were transferred to Ofgem in 2013. In 2015, we launched our own non-transactional energy price comparison site. And last year, the CMA nominated us to provide the backstop full of market price comparison tool. So to tackle the question of the day is sort of, could we have a market without switching sites? Could we have a market without commercial switching sites? And I don't think we can. The decision-making process in regulated markets is complex, and sites have a user-friendly model to help simplify this process. They're well-established, profitable, and with the money to invest in new services and the latest technological developments. Non-commercial switching site models do exist in other countries, but in Britain, I think a government-run model would be at risk of lacking the skills or experience to run a slick and consumer-friendly site to be able to compete with the commercial rivals. So the challenge for us is to ensure that switching sites have a healthy or positive impact on the markets they operate in. In the energy sector, there's been some tweaks to the core TPI model over the years, with the entrance of collective switching schemes or next generation intermediaries, some working with smaller commission levels, and flippers upfront charge to consumers as opposed to taking a per switch commission from suppliers has been the most significant challenge to the model to date. But however these sites choose to operate, we mustn't forget that they're all businesses providing service for which they get paid handsomely, and they're not consumer champions. With the CMA's controversial decision to remove the whole market requirement, it's more important than ever that this is made clear to consumers. The blurring of rules is very common, mainly because many media organisations have partnerships with TPIs. So within the energy market, we've got a minority of switchers who are more likely to be financially comfortable households, but the majority of consumers are non-switchers or very infrequent switchers, and that group's more likely to be financially distressed or vulnerable households. And if the CMA's remedy leads to greater competition between sites and amongst suppliers, that's good news for their client base, but the benefits are less clear for the rest of the population at this stage. During the inquiry, we warned the CMA about the risks of having engagement messages encouraging people to shop around on multiple sites. Because how that sounds to consumers is, you know, that job you already find quite complicated, time-consuming, off-putting. Well, it's now even more consuming because you should be checking multiple sites to see where you're getting the best deal for you. There are a small minority of people who are super bargain hunters and already shop around on multiple sites, but it isn't realistic to expect the majority of households to adopt these behaviours. People are busy, the decision-making process for many markets is complex, so it's easier to defer making a decision. Last autumn, we surveyed 8,000 consumers to gauge views on the whole of market issue, and 94% of energy consumers felt it was important for sites to show all available tariffs. 70% of people said that this was essentially very important to them. More engaged consumers, aka the existing users of these sites, were more likely to say that a whole of market comparison was important to them. So that's another caution for sites keen to take advantage of these new freedoms. In this new world, the Citizens Advice tool will be the backstop providing information about all energy tariffs. And our rationale for launching an energy price comparison tool was our ability to reach people who wouldn't be comfortable using a big name switching site. It complements our existing outreach programs like Energy Best Deal or the Big Energy Saving Network, as well as our assisted digital strategy through our network. But our existing tool is only half the solution because you can't switch on our site. And making the switching process speedy and simple is the USP of these businesses. Whether or not our tool should become transactional is under consideration. But unlike other organizations, Citizens Advice has never had a commercial arm, and nor would we want to be just another switching site. So our advocacy work is focused on how to ensure these services can better meet the needs of all consumers. And we've shortly be publishing a research report which confirms that we've got a two-tier market in all sectors where TPIs are common. Competitive markets are working for some, but not all, as existing sites don't meet the needs of less confident consumers. And this is a big concern for those regulated markets providing essential services. People who don't engage pay more, with savings of up to $300 a year available in the energy market alone. And a key sticking point for many of these households is the concerns about what these sites do with your data. So the challenges for TPIs and regulators is to address concerns about how they collect and use data, by giving consumers more control and choice over these options, as well as making their sites more inclusive. The other major conclusion is that there needs to be more support available if we want consumers to be able to use TPIs to shop around in different markets. For the government, there needs to be more emphasis placed on building up people's digital literacy skills to give them the knowledge and the tools to help participate in a competitive market. There is a skills gap in this country, and it needs to be addressed because people are being left behind. Our research also confirms the importance of key influencers like Martin Lewis, who can help reassure people that these sites and services are safe to use. I mean, whatever the case, switching sites are a fact of life, and it's hard to see a world where their role and impact doesn't continue to increase. But given their power and influence on market, continued oversight and monitoring by regulators is essential. And this will ensure that all TPIs operate fairly, transparently, and consistently to help deliver the right outcomes for consumers, not just the active minority.
Thank you, Ginny. Richard, over to you. There's quite a lot for you to respond to there.
I was just going to say that the trouble isn't going third, fourth, and this sort of thing is so much as I'm going to say is probably going to be repeating some, but not all of the earlier speakers. But anyway, I'm Richard Neudegg. I'm head of regulation at uSwitch.com. For those that don't know, uSwitch is one of these switching sites that we've heard so much about. We started 16, 17 years ago in energy, and since then have broadened into broadband, mobile, insurance, and personal finance products as well. We're also part of Zuka Property Group, Zuka and Prime Location, so have had an experience of being kind of intermediary, trying to make things easier for consumers in lots of different markets. And I guess we've all started from the same premise so far about how best to get good consumer outcomes in, you know, privatised utility markets, is that competition is the best way, conceptually, assuming the markets are working, to do that. I think that's a better way than, say, price regulating the market, where you can achieve, like in water, a lot more fairness in pricing, but you forego the opportunity for firms to really feel the pressure to make more efficiencies and to innovate and to kind of really push on price and service. But we have to accept in competitive markets, the onus is on a consumer to engage to make those markets work effectively. And you'll find switching sites wherever there is a kind of market that needs, consumers need kind of that extra bit of help to cut through the inevitable complexity. And have been really successful in doing that in a number of markets, not just in the utilities markets, but anything. You think you're booking a hotel or a flight or whatever, there's some site there that's there to make that easy for you. We also have to accept in competitive markets that there will be pricing differentials between the engaged and the disengaged. Those hyper-engaged consumers looking for the best deal will be paying the least, and those that are not engaged with the market will be paying more. I don't have any problem if those that are disengaged are wealthy consumers who £300 saving a year is not worth 20 minutes of their time and they're making an active decision to do that. The problem comes when those that are disengaged are those that really could use the savings that are on offer. Then they tend to be those from more challenging backgrounds, and that's really obviously where policymakers, I think, need to focus attention. I think what we're seeing in energy with the CMA and everything else is about really thinking, how do we leverage the competitive market that is there to start addressing those different consumer groups, the ones that are less disengaged. And for uSwitch as part, our approach in trying to reach consumers is to invest a lot in television advertising, is to, you know, obviously other forms of marketing as well, and print and online, and to have a contact centre that targets customers that aren't able to use or don't want to use online, and also to run community events as well that target, you know, groups that wouldn't otherwise go through those different kinds of channels. I think where the trick with a lot of this is to do that sort of activity for many different intermediaries, different entities and suppliers on a much bigger scale. And just to kind of draw on some of the points that were made earlier about what is the reason people don't engage? And actually, I think an energy switching process is pretty good. There are definitely savings to be had. I think primarily it's the confidence and the message that it's easy to do that. And it's getting that message to consumers and giving them the tools and confidence to do that. And that's where leveraging a competitive market to do a lot more marketing, a lot more getting the message out there through the kind of level of competitive intensity from different intermediaries is something we can see a lot more of. I draw a comparison with energy to say motor insurance, which we've also talked about so far, where we see switching levels significantly higher than we see in communications, energy and other markets, sort of 35-40% a year. Some of that is due to kind of renewal cycle, but also it's no coincidence that some of the big name comparison sites pummel us with incredibly memorable, I was going to say irritating, 9 million uSwitches, with the exception of uSwitches adverts, very memorable adverts, on a massive scale. And that stuff does lead to switching. Again, as Ed was talking about, the Power to Switch campaign had a clear impact on the number of switches when it was running. It's no coincidence that marketing to consumers does drive switching numbers. So we need to see a lot more of that, we need to leverage that. I'll just make a couple of comments on regulation as well. I think, and this has been touched on already, that the regulatory focus in this space has been on quite a traditional definition of what a price comparison site is. A lot of the tools, accreditation schemes focus on this quite narrow area, but as we've discussed, it's quite right. There are a lot more models out there. So you see the big deal, collective switching, there's Flipper with automatic switching, there are offline switching tools, there are apps, there are other comparison services that that aren't covered by, say, Ofgem's conference code at the moment, including Martin Lewis's Mind Saving Expert Cheap Energy Club. So if we're going to really use the competitive market to leverage this kind of real boost in trying to reach those consumers, we do need to make sure that consumers' confidence is maintained and their trust is maintained. And regulation does have a role there. I do think that we need to think seriously about how we more broadly cover the kind of wide range of intermediaries and switching services that are out there as part of that to make sure that we don't store up any consumer trust issues in the future. I mean, on consumer trust, I think the primary issue here is you store up a consumer trust problem where consumers have expectations that aren't met in reality. And whatever is decided to do with questions over whole of market, which I would imagine are going to be covered in the Q&A, but maybe I'm jumping the gun, whatever happens with that, we need to make sure that consumers have the right expectations going into the services that they're able to use, so they don't believe they're getting something that they're not. So I guess to sum up, my kind of proposition would be, we need to leverage and encourage greater competitive intensity between different switching sites, a broad definition of that, to increase consumer engagement and to drive more wider market competition. We need to maintain trust in services, switching services along the way, and we need to ensure the regulatory approach is not fragmented and encourages innovation and competition. I think it's not easy to reconcile those three things, incidentally, and clearly some of the debate will focus on that, but I do think it is possible to reconcile them. But it does take a really pragmatic approach from policymakers that on some issues may seem initially counterintuitive. But at the end of the day, I think we just have to be, think really hard about what is pragmatically actually going to deliver more consumers and the right consumers accessing better prices and better service.
Thank you, Richard. Will.
Great.
Am I on?
You're on.
Hi, I'm Will Hodson. I'm co-founder of thebigdeal.com. We are a collective switching site, so Ed, in many ways, is my business godfather, having allowed us to take off as we did. So we've been around for a few years now, and we look to provide an alternative to your orthodox comparison site experience. We're focused on energy, and the first industry whose health I am in a position to comment on would be energy. Now, I take as my primary focus the energy retail market. That's what we're looking at. Is that healthy? What do comparison sites tell us about that, about how it works? And only secondarily would I say, now let's look at comparison sites as its own industry, because it's huge. And is that working? So the first point is, big picture, no brainer, are comparison sites a good thing? And I would say yes. Where you have a complicated industry, people won't be able to work out what their kilowatt hours are per year. They need to find the best deal. Comparison sites can do that. You can find it there. That's a good thing. But if you take a step back, a couple of things leap out at you. First of all, what does it tell you about energy supply operations? That every single one of them, after nearly three decades of liberal opportunity, a liberalized market, every single one we brought under the yoke of a comparison site and said, you know what, you're all just numbers. You can all be compared on price. There is nothing to distinguish a supplier out there in the eyes of a consumer. Now that's one thing that comparison sites tell us about the British consumer's energy experience. The second thing is, and this is more about comparison sites and how they work for us on that narrow remit of can we get the best price, because goodness knows energy suppliers aren't delivering something else. Well, if they are this Darwinian, this digital Darwinian agent that can root out the inefficient and reward the efficient, it doesn't seem to have worked. Because when the energy industry was referred to the CMA and consumers were having a bad deal, getting a raw deal, you'd have to look to the so-called consumer champions and say, why is it that people are being overcharged? If for the last 16 years, we've had people going from the worst and to the best, why is it that someone like SSE can have 90% of their customers on their worst deal? Why is it the CMA told us that 70% of customers were on the worst deal they could be on? Now, to me, that's a fail. And you have to ask yourself, how does that work? What's the truth behind it? I thought, you know, comparison sites are doing well. You know, you've got Money Supermarket worth $1 billion. You know, uSwitch changed hands around 200 million, Zoopla. These are big, successful companies. And yet consumers are getting a raw deal. So what's the truth of it? What's working? What kind of energy market is a comparison site overseeing? And I think it brings you on to the concept of a tease and squeeze economy. Now, I think we all kind of know what it means. You're brought in on a very, very cheap deal. When that deal expires, you're rolled up to a far more expensive one. It's a bit like a switching treadmill. You have to stay on it all the time. Now, Rich has written a blog, I believe, in the past around things like the tale of two energy markets. And this would make us think there were just two markets, and it's just people who do switch, who get a great deal. They're there, it's almost kind of, you know, telepathically linked to Martin Lewis. It says, do it, they're on it, they switch. I would say maybe 10% of the population fall into that. They're on a great deal. And then we say, there's this poor, abandoned rump of the country that doesn't switch, and these guys get royally milked. I don't think it's, I think there's a third constituency. A third constituency of people who have switched, but then gave up. They hear, because we talked about how people had switched, and then they said, you know what, in the end, it seemed like I wasn't on a great deal. They probably checked after a year. When they weren't on a great deal, they got rolled up. So people think, you know, I have to keep doing it. I have to switch every year. Now, can I really do this? But that's very much the model of comparison sites. So I think that has two implications for the market as a consumer. If you are someone more inclined to switch, then it's at the back of your mind always that you have to keep doing it. You're never free of that nagging fear and suspicion that you have to keep switching. That's not great. It doesn't have to be that way. And if people who never switch, right, they don't do it at all. These guys are increasingly propping up the industry. Now, we were on the BBC Watchdog show a few weeks ago talking about the growing gap between a supplier's best deal and a supplier's worst deal. And I think it's a scandal. I think it's a disgrace. Since we've been working in collective switching, we've seen that gap grow from about 30% to about 62%. That was the biggest differential that we saw. That means that if your neighbour is paying £1,000 for their energy on, it was NPower, on NPower's best deal, then you could be paying £1,620. 620 quid, deadweight loss. No difference, just you weren't on the right tariff. And I don't think that's right. But there's something in the comparison model that says get people in cheap. Now this is a feature of bringing people great deals in the first instance. You get them a fantastic deal, which means their rival says, we've got to go cheaper than that. And the next guy says, we've got to go cheaper still. And before you know it, you're getting very close to deals being underwater, deals maybe not being profitable in the first year. And that has two implications. First of all, they have to make sure they get the money out of you in years two and three. And second, if you go, they have to make sure they get their money back from the people who never switch. And that's what I would call part of this tease and squeeze, cheap first year, make money in years two and three model. And I think it's definitely something to be worked on. I think it's something that, you know, we need to look at sort of the government level. The CMA hasn't talked about an enormous amount, but in theory, it should be impossible. It should be impossible if you don't have loss leaders. It should be impossible if you go after predatory pricing. But I think those things have made it, have been largely ignored. I think it's had an impact on consumers. And I think also it's had an impact on independent suppliers. Because the people who you often see with the cheapest prices on comparison sites are 100% not the most efficient suppliers. So how do they get a price that cheap? There's an argument, classically in economics, that you use a larger customer base to prop that up. I think we need to look at that. If we have any hope at all of getting these non-switchers to switch, it's going to be about trust. And one of the reasons that Ed set up collective switching, or enabled collective switching, and seeded it in the UK was comparison sites have largely reached the parts of the population they're going to reach. Then there are other people who don't look to Martin Lewis, they don't look to an ITV advert, they look instead to maybe their local government, that, you know, local council. Maybe they follow their, you know, they trust their national newspaper most of all. And those guys can be engaged. But the main thing for them, people who have been just found out that they've been ripped off, you know, they've spent £3,000 too much over the last 10 years, which was, you know, I think the figures we came up with last summer. What really matters to someone who's been told you've been taken for a ride is that they can trust the person who's telling them that, which is why trust is so important. And that's the big issue. So Richard's anticipated, talk about whole of market. Trust, in the context of comparison site, means are they honestly showing you the deals that they said they were going to show you? When you've been brought in to find the cheapest energy deal for you, are you going to find it? So a bit of history, people don't know it. In 2014, we found that uSwitch and others have been hiding the cheapest deals on the market and steering visitors to their website instead towards the deals that paid them a commission. That went on the front page of the Sun newspaper, Britain's biggest paper. After that, Citizens Advice came in and said this isn't right, people should be shown the best deals. The Energy Select Committee came in, very, very clear position, you know, people want to see the best deals. Then the people themselves came in and said very, very clearly, 86% of us, according to YouGov, want to see the best deals, whether or not it earns a comparison site a commission. And I think whether or not the CMA believe we have to enable these intermediaries, we have to have them encouraged and incentivized, whether or not they think they have to prop up the business model of comparison sites, they have to keep them honest. Because bit by bit, trust in businesses is ebbing away. And there is an argument for regulation in energy, which is an essential good, an essential service. So I'd like to see, to really have these guys as part of the solution and not potentially contributing to the problem, I'd like to see a whole of market requirement there. I'd like to see honest advice as a must. I'd also like to see them do their bit to avoid the many propping up the few. And that means things like avoiding predatory pricing, allowing a greater view on whether we have loss leaders in there, and whether we have the last, most loyal customers propping up people who get the cheapest deals. And also, you know, an increasing worry I think for people is, after the CMA's recommendations, there's going to be a situation where the cheapest deal that a supplier offers can be refused to their loyal customers. I think that's wrong as well. That's not because of comparison sites, but comparison sites have a role to play in clearing up. And that's why that's.
Thank you, Will. Some really good and mildly contentious points, which is excellent and should be encouraged. I wanted to pick up on two things and then I'll throw it open to some questions from the audience. The first is really some of what you touched on, well actually well, everyone touched on this a bit, but I define the scope of the event kind of narrowly around switching sites, but actually I think it's this whole debate around, well there's a much wider debate that sits within around retail market competition in general. So I suppose, Will, you kind of threw the gauntlet down there pretty hard in terms of, you know, there is switching that goes on. Let's take the energy market as an example. There is switching that goes on. Switching rates have gone up in the last couple of years, although actually in the door-to-door sales years they were much higher again. But there is switching activity that goes on, and you've got a very competitive section of the market. Yeah, so maybe this switching is better than the old switching. That may well be the case, and actually it's harder to get a sense of that. So that's all sort of happened, and yet we've still got this kind of segmentation of the market with standard variable tariffs. You know, the profit margins on those are huge, and then you've got these predatory pricing, you know, potentially loss-leading tariffs at the other end. So, and the rump of people still, you know, the 90%+ of SSE customers still on the SVT. So, you know, why is that not, how is that where we've ended up? I don't know whether anyone wants to build on any of those points.
I'd just lay a point on that, because this is where I see so many similarities to the financial services sector, where you get drawn in. Take credit cards as an example. You know, some fantastic kind of balance transfer deals or purchase deals for 1, 2, 3 years. And then if you drop off, you get hit hard. And actually, people who are not kind of moving around with credit cards are paying high rates and are funding those who are very engaged in the market. Similarly, it's the same with car insurance. You've got to be kind of switching on a regular basis to really be getting the best deal. So you go back to your point in terms of you can get a year and then actually I can't bother this year. And actually it's slowly but, you know, over time. So, but I think, certainly from my point of view, I think that consumers are getting this more in some sectors. So car insurance, we see more switching. Goes back to your point in terms of, somebody's point in terms of the advertising, in terms of it's really, really pushed. And I think we've got to do this kind of communication piece in terms of you've got switching the first place and using the site, but actually continual switching. But you're right to say it's ridiculous that we find ourselves in a situation where we've got some kind of on people on very cheap rates and deals, but then those who are kind of really paying for those consumers. But I think we do see it across sectors, and what we need to do is learn from those in terms of what can we do to just get that engagement.
I completely agree with that, and I think the point of the credit market is extremely well made. If you look at some prices that people pay for their credit, it's extraordinary compared to the well-heeled middle-class internet savvy, if you like. So this is not an observation that's unique to energy markets, absolutely far from it. That's not saying we shouldn't worry about it. I think we, those of us who believe in the market economy, want to make sure the market economy works for the most vulnerable as well. It's a good test of it. And that's where the policy needs to sort of think that through. Now, sometimes that will mean regulation of the market, sometimes it will mean non-regulatory methods, sometimes it will mean methods outside the market. But we need to be clear about what the market is delivering and what the right intervention is to try to assist those people who are unfairly, slightly inverted commas, not benefiting from that market solution. So you know, you could be more radical. One thing we I think succeeded in doing was reducing the barriers to entry into the supply market. We've seen a proliferation of supply, and I think that extra competition has helped put pressure on prices. But clearly, for the reason we've tried, it's not enough. One thing that I put forward and was told it was far too radical, Minister, was that, you know, when we put in regulations for Ofgem that they should put on the bottom of the bill their best tariff for their customer. I suggested that we put the best tariff in the market on the bill, even if it wasn't from that supplier. I think the civil servant sort of fell off their seat and said, well, I'm not sure that'll go down too well, Minister. I sort of wish I'd done that, because that would have made me even more popular with the industry. So I think we need to, there are ways we can address some of these issues, and we need to keep thinking about it. But we shouldn't be so surprised that some markets deliver these types of outcomes. They're not that unusual. And the job of policymakers is to keep watching it, whether it's the competition authorities, industry regulators, or ministers, keep watching it and seeing how things can be improved. Continuous improvement.
One of the learnings that I take from other markets is that some of the there's certain things that happen in other markets, certain events. So in other markets, it's much more common to have a fixed deal which has an end, and then once you've gone past that end, you're sort of, you know, you're out of contract. You know, a lot of the language, I think in energy we could learn a lot about the language of how this is all done from other markets. So I think in car insurance, people are very used to the idea that you get car insurance for 12 months and then you have to renew it and you have to go through a process. I know that my renewal is always in December, so I always have to do that in December. It's a pain in the ass. It's the wrong time to have to do it, because it's December. Just before Christmas, I have to pay this, whatever it is. But I know that that's the timing, so it's a sort of a stimulus for me to think about it. But in energy, you can kind of people are on fixed tariffs, but you can also be back on the standard variable tariff, and you kind of don't notice.
A regulation to ban
auto roaming.
Well, the switching sites would love that, wouldn't they?
Yeah. They would. But that would get, it may not to ban auto rollover altogether, but just change the language. Well, nobody really understands what an SVT is.
I think if I could just add something to that. I think this comes to the tale of two markets point, I think. Because I do think actually there are a good number of consumers in the energy market who are used to that, and the kind of proliferation of short-term fixed deals that often run 12 months, I think actually does get some consumers into that habit. And I think we shouldn't focus too much on that, because the issue actually is the 66%, I think it is now, who aren't in that cycle. It's about getting them into that cycle, and I think that's what the CMA's eyebrow-raising database
represents. Well, yeah,
but that is targeting that kind of problem. So, you know, I think there are potentials to kind of extract those learnings out of other sectors, but we do need to focus on that.
My suggestion was more about changing the language than male shotting everyone to death. Will, you wanted to come in?
No, I was just to say that the prompt to engage, you're exactly right, that the prompt to engage is currently left very much in the hands of precisely the agent who doesn't want you to engage, which is crazy. So the way that you have that, the way they word that reminder, the cheapest tariff message, I think it's called, where they place it on the bill, they've got every incentive for you to not actually take any notice, which is odd. And funnily enough, I think actually, if they could say, here's the best deal in the market, a lot of bigger suppliers, if they work out you're always going to be on the best deal, would soon you'd be on the best deal elsewhere every year. Because if there's not much money in their best deal, then soon you go away. And that's something that could happen if you have acquisition-only tariffs. So it's fair enough. You know, if we get the message clearly that someone, once they're in, they want to stay on our absolute best deal, well, you can refuse them the best deals after that. That's a worry. I think looking at that could help prevent that kind of inter-customer exploitation.
And I think that's the other challenge of where this market is going. It's sort of companies will have much greater data about their customers, and within that data they know full well who's going to switch and who is their sticky rump. And that can be exploited as more and more is known about these customers, because they're going to be able to segment their customers very easily.
I've got a question actually, because there's a big point here, which is, you know, what does comparison sites say about the health of the energy market? Another way to word that is, what do you know about a market when the consumer champion is paid by the people trying to overcharge us? So is it possible, well, let's say the suppliers, they work for suppliers. Now, is it possible to combine that business model, where you're paid by suppliers, who need to make some money out of customers at some point, is it possible to combine that with keeping someone the best deal always?
Are you talking about us?
No, I'm talking about comparison sites.
Richard, do you want to respond to that? It sounds like a challenge to you.
The likes of Flipper or something would have an answer to that sort of question. I mean, comparison sites have always been about giving consumers the tools to engage with the market. A consumer is making a decision about whether to switch or whether to not switch. On the point about business models, I do think it is a compatible model. I think switching sites, certainly from usage's point of view, is a very significant consumer-facing brand. We know every day that if our customers didn't have trust in us and didn't like the service that we're providing, they would not use us and we would cease to exist pretty quickly. You know, there might be barriers to switching your energy supplier, but there's very few barriers to switching your comparison site. So we're painfully aware of that. I mean, you've also got to remember as well that the vast majority of people who see a comparison table, results table on uSwitch, don't switch to us. I mean, less than 10% actually go through with the transaction through us. So there's a large kind of side benefit of the presence of a free model, that a lot of information is getting to consumers, where we've taken the risk of spending a lot of money on marketing to get the message out there, to get someone to our service with no guarantee that they're actually going to switch with us at all. Now, some do, and there is actually an additional benefit of using the switching service, in that there's less admin and phoning around, and it's an efficient way of acquiring customers from an energy supplier's point of view. But, you know, you take us out of the mix, and you're starting from, you know, three steps back. That's not to say that, you know, switching sites are the answer to everything. I think we need everything. We need collective switching schemes, we need the flippers, we need the uSwitches, we need all of it. Because this is a really big challenge that we all need to meet head on.
So, just sort of building on that, this is the last question I'll ask and then we'll open it up. Is this whole thing about whole of market? So I think Ed declared his position on it. I think, Gillian, you declared your position on it. Well, I think I probably know you want to. So quite a lot of support for the idea that switching sites should be obliged to show a whole of market comparison. And there's a lot of history about this. I think it's quite interesting because in energy there's a lot of debate about this and people saying, oh well, you know, maybe there should be a whole of market comparison. And we have gone from a place where there was a whole of market comparison to a place where now you're allowed to not have a whole of market. I mean, I've explained this to a few people, you know, just and they find it remarkable, but that the government or the CMA rather has lots of politicians have argued against the CMA. The CMA have the regulator is saying that we should remove this whole of market thing. Lots of people find that kind of staggering that the regulator's done that. But so I don't know, Amanda, whether you want to comment or Richard.
It was somewhat when I kind of saw it, I was a bit like, Well, I suppose I looked at it in the context of maybe in the, you know, the talk about, you know, moving from fixed four tariffs and then going, well, actually, when you do whole market, we're going to become so complicated. But I have to say, my natural instinct was that we need to give people choice. And I think it really does go back to that point, is four the right number? And I know your blog talked about, you know, have we gone from one extreme to the other? And my feeling is we probably have gone from one extreme to another. And I just wonder whether that was one of the drivers between, you know, for the CMA looking into that. Because I think there's been quite a lot of debate and quite a lot of surprise.
I don't think it could be. I mean, the history is that, I mean, I wasn't really that keen on retail market review Ofgem proposing four tariffs. I thought four tariffs was too few. I think we had got into a very crazy world where it was completely obfuscating, but four tariffs looked to me too few. But I was dealing with then the Prime Minister who said it should be one tariff. So, you know, I was just so grateful he said that on the week before the RMR came out from Ofgem, because I could say, hold on, Prime Minister, let's go for four. And I was still being argued down to two or three, and I had to push to four. It was quite bizarre, I have to tell you. But through that process, it became clear you could have quite a few tariffs and still have whole of market switching websites. No problem.
On whole of market, can I quickly add? We've talked so far about the importance of whole of market from a trust perspective, and that is the first point. But there's a second, there's an economics point and a competition point here, which is, you know, if you think that there is a strong grip of energy suppliers on the energy market, you know, the big comparison sites are far more dominant, actually. So you look at the top two energy suppliers, British Gas, SSE, they probably have, maybe someone could tell me, 30% of the market, I guess, between them. About that? Feel like you know. No, about 30%. So he's turning it up. About 30%. If you look at Money Supermarket and uSwitch, it's well above 50%. Far more concentrated market. Now, if you say to a comparison site, from now on, if someone doesn't pay the commission that you want, you can exclude them. They're out. What would you do? You'd probably put up your commission. Because you know they can't really, they've got not much negotiating power. So that's why I think that not just from a trust point of view, but also from a basic economics point of view, giving already dominant comparison sites more market power to set commissions high, and commissions end up on our bills, that's a cost we all face, I think that would be completely wrong-headed and I'd get the wrong outcome.
Richard, I'll allow you to defend all this. Well, why are we all
start? Whole of market or dominance?
No, whole of market. Well, I'll start with whole of market.
I mean, I think this dominance point with respect to us is slightly overblown. I think some of the statistics that come out in this area have again looked at a very narrow definition of what a price comparison site is. And I think the switching market as a whole, about the various different routes and marketing channels that are available to someone that's considering switching, is a lot more vast than just the narrow definition of, you know, the top five comparison sites or whatever. I don't think we have done. So I think it's quite a, I mean, it's quite an interesting observation given the size of the organisations that comparison sites are. Against these kind of multi-billion pound ginormous energy suppliers, to claim that we have dominance over them is
dominance in your own market, so there's a grip. So
well, we are negotiating directly with energy suppliers over issues on commission. So, I mean, that's just an observation, I guess, on whole of market. I mean, this is an example, I guess, of whether something as a counterintuitive on the surface is going to pragmatically make a difference to the actual objectives that everyone wants to see. I mean, clearly the CMA's view is that was a significant part of their wider package. I mean, just to return, what they were pushing for is they were looking for comparison sites to leverage a lot more competitive pressure onto suppliers by negotiating exclusive deals, and the collective effect of that would be to kind of exert a much kind of bigger downward pressure on pricing, and that would be a good objective to achieve. I mean, I would go back again to the trust point. I think, just to reiterate it, consumer trust is extremely important to uSwitch. And we realise that if people didn't trust us, people wouldn't use us. The critical thing is that whatever comes out of this is that consumer expectation meets reality. I don't believe it's the same. I don't believe it's the same thing to say comparison sites should offer hold of market and the rules should require them to offer hold of market. And I think you may very well see if there wasn't a requirement to offer hold of market, some may still seek to do it, because it's about making sure that they can market their service to their consumers in a certain way, and the side benefit of that might be greater market competition. So it's something that needs a lot of careful thought, actually, about whether actually there may be some benefits here that are worthwhile. And one final point, again, returning to what I said before, is I do believe that we need a lot more than just your uSwitch and your Money Supermarket in the market advertising and doing all this kind of stuff. We need it on a much more epic scale. And the switching rates are very small. We need this a lot more. And it's totally, in my view, achievable. I think there's a lot more in the, not more able to achieve in the switching rates by looking at other markets. I think we can get consumer engagement up. And the harsh reality is, you know, uSwitch, we, regardless of the whole market advertising and everything else, but we do need other people to come in, and there does need to be a commercial incentive for them to chuck lots of private sector money in marketing and advertising. So there may need to be a uncomfortable trade-off if we're really going to start to move the needle on some of these issues.
So my
controversial perspective.
My final word on whole of market, or one suggestion I put out there, was that you could do whole of market with the exception of exclusive deals. As in, you as uSwitch would have to show all the deals from all the suppliers, and you could also show ones that were exclusive to you, but compare the market wouldn't get the uSwitch exclusive only deals.
I'd be worried if we weren't allowed to show our own deals that were exclusive.
No,
to
you can show some, exactly. But you get they've talked about it in, I think it's mentioned in the UKRN report on this stuff, and this kind of most favoured nation status. I don't know quite.
I mean, we do need to remember in energy, this is pretty much the only sector where whole of market really exists.
Indeed.
In comparison.
Yeah.
It's present nowhere else. I mean, in fact, motor insurance, again, where we see the highest switching levels, not only do not all the comparison sites have all of the insurers, but then they do have the same insurers, they return a totally different price.
Right.
So this is not a unique feature to energy.
But I think we should still take what's good in the energy sector and apply it to other sectors. That's also the lesson that can be learned from this.
I think that's true, although we've got to look at the competition dynamics and the reason behind that. I think there is also a practicality question in energy and compatibility with the other CMA remedies, particularly the removal of formal tariffs. You know, for example, one of the reasons we can't do a whole of market comparison in, like, you know, TV content is because you can phone up Sky and threaten to leave and get a deal that is not existent anywhere else.
Yeah.
We have no sight of that. So for us to say our service is whole of market there would be false. And I would be, if we're going to move to that kind of direction in energy, which is possible under the rules with the sort of tariffs that are available on different channels and all of that, I'd be really nervous about perpetuating the idea that whole of market is even achievable, because I think we're saving up a kind of much worse consumer trust issue to come further down the line. You know, we'll be the first to kind of point out these things. So if we're not honest about the service that is actually there and make sure consumer expectations are aligned with reality, we're going to be here in a couple of years' time talking about how awful the energy market is and how something needs to be done.
Well, maybe let's do that. Right, let's throw it open to some questions. I think this gentleman in the second row. There's a roving mic, so please say who you are and where you're from.
Yeah, hi. I'm Nigel Evans. I've spent most of my professional life trying to encourage competition in energy markets. I'm also the co-founder and chairman of Flipper. When Gillian said that she felt that none of the participants, the PCWs, the intermediates, are consumer champions, I must say, my initial thought was I bridled strongly. And then I realised, no, she's absolutely correct. I'm not a consumer champion at all. I'm a businessman trying to establish a viable, successful business offering benefits to customers in return for payment. That's what I am. I'm not a consumer champion. However, I'm quite happy to say what we do, and perhaps you would judge whether or not that makes any sense from the consumer's point of view. In FIPA, we don't receive commission payments. We charge customers a fee, and that fee is only payable if the savings we can find are more than twice the level of the fee. We cover the whole of market. The whole issue as to whether or not there should be regulation associated with that doesn't particularly interest me. Fish and chip vendors don't need regulations to tell them to sell fish and chips. It's not of interest. That's what we do. We actually switch our customers too, so they don't have to do the switching. We find the deals and do the switching. But having done that, we keep the market under review for the customers based on their own consumption.
Sorry, would you mind bringing it into a question? It's a great speech, but what's the question?
Well, it's a comment as much as anything. The experience that our customers have got is they realize that not only can they make savings the first time in, they will repeatedly make savings. So when we're concerned about some of the deals that are offered, the squeeze and tease deals, some of the services already, which will keep switching people into the tease, are available, and our service does. Others may well do it as well. So we've saved customers huge sums by switching them from very high cost SVT to another supplier, and then back to the original supplier, because they're then available for the new deals. In terms of where regulation should go, my own feeling is that we can go too far here. That if you look at the Ofgem customer code, and this
I'm just going to have to ask you, can you ask a question? And then, because there's lots of other people who want to ask a question.
Okay, in that case, I would just say there's a lot going on. Don't do too much too soon. I think you'll see some innovation.
Okay, no, that's great. And actually, I'm very interested in Philip, but who else would like to ask a question? Rob from OVO.
Hi. Quick, simple question. What is a sign of a healthy market? Or you're interested in the panel's views, with specific reference to metrics. So we've talked a lot about the number of people on SVTs. Do people have a percentage figure in mind of the number of the number that has to come down to, the number that percentage of switches needs to go up to, or even looking at pricing, the actual difference in price between the cheapest and the most expensive tariff that suppliers have?
It's a great question. My sense would be that it doesn't necessarily have to all be about switching, because actually you could, it's about consumer detriment, isn't it? And in the CMA's language, they've identified this 2 billion consumer detriment. You could chip away at that either through switching or through other things which cause suppliers to have a more competitive SVT in the first place. I don't know if there are any other views.
Yeah. I was going to say, within that, I think it's really important who's switching. So if you have a market where, you know, the more vulnerable households are in the group that isn't switching and are paying more, that's a real problem. And I think if we're looking to the success of the CMA remedies, it's getting that, changing the component of who isn't switching in that market. We want to see a massive shift so more vulnerable households aren't within the group that are being left behind.
I think that's right, just to add to that. I mean, I think there are a number of metrics that you can look at. I do think switching is one of them, but I don't think the switching target needs to be 100% of people every year. But I do think it needs to be higher than it is now. And we've said publicly that we think 25% should be a stretch target. You know, we know that it has been achieved before, albeit with face-to-face and other kind of problems there, those kind of levels. So we should be looking to measure all of those things. But beyond metric, I know you asked metrics, but beyond that, I think that the key thing actually is that suppliers really need to feel the power of their customers properly, and they need to be worrying as much about retaining their existing customers as acquiring new ones. So you need to have the level of engagement enough to do that. And that's where the competitive market can, the switchers can help the non-switchers, in that they start to worry about losing their business as well. What that level is, I don't know, but that's got to be the objective.
Will? Yep, a very short answer. I think it's a really good question. I think it's fairly simple. Actually, you're looking for some measure of surplus, in detriment of what's the difference between what you are being charged and what you could be charged. I wouldn't say you need to collect to the bone, although in theory that's the competitive, that's the orthodoxy of how it should be. I think there probably is a margin of 40, 50 quid where you have something of the service or something about the ethos or the ethics of the company you admire and you like. But beyond that, I think you were just measuring the surplus, and you could weight it according to which part of the population that really can't afford to be paying that surplus.
Can I just pick up, I'm not going to have numbers, but it's about a dynamic market, which is, there's a number of different metrics where you look at the market, you segment it and see how they're behaving. But I want to just go back to Flipper very briefly, and because I think what I would like to see and what we're seeing in other markets is how disruptive technology is changing models. And we see this across a whole wide range. And I think this is another market where I would hope, as we see a business model like yours, which is challenging the traditional ways in which people consider switching. And to that point, that's where we have a challenge from a regulation perspective. On the committee, we did a whole load of work on the digital technology and how regulation struggles. You take taxis as a very obvious example. So it will be interesting to see how disruptive technology pushes this forward.
Can I just take on that point? Because I think this is slightly blue sky thinking, but if you divide the average energy bill, third power, two-thirds gas, which is effectively what it is, the power side of that could change quite dramatically in the next decade. There's a big debate, I'm sure people have heard about it, about prosumers. The idea that people, mainly with solar panels or not, exclusive solar panels, will be producing their own power. If you bring in cheap forms of storage to that, which is already on the market, it's a bit expensive at the moment, but with things like half-hourly settlements, it's going to fall dramatically. A lot of power supply, you could easily see that being self-produced. There's other technologies, not just that are in the family of artificial intelligence, particularly something called blockchain technology. You can see that creating communities, trading amongst themselves, almost outside the grid. These things will completely transform the retail side of electricity. And you'd almost get rid of the supplier, potentially, in some of these models, which would, I'm afraid, be bad news for you guys. On the power side, you wouldn't need any switching sites. On the gas side, it's a bit more unsure, because we're not sure what's going to happen on the heating side. We should be blooming sure energy efficiency in warmer homes and insulation and so on is going to be a big part of that, but we don't know whether it's going to be electrification, whether it's going to be district heating, whether it's going to be hydrogen, and we just don't know, right? I mean, people will tell you they know, but they don't know, and it's a bit unclear. We've still got to do quite a lot of work. But I think the public policy issue, to come back to trying to bring this sort of future thinking to this debate, actually is still around the fuel poor. And the way you help the fuel poor, who are always going to struggle in the market, is to make sure we have insulation programs and programs to try to make sure the homes of the people who are less well off are properly insulated. And that isn't that expensive. I have big arguments with Treasury, which I won't bore you with. But we did reform the way we measured fuel poverty when I was Secretary of State, after a huge amount of work, working with people like CAB and others, the NEA and others, because the way we started measuring fuel poverty was really inaccurate. The Queen was in fuel poverty, according to that previous measure. But we've got a much better handle on how you should measure fuel poverty. And I think with that, with the strategy we set out, we really went for that. Some of the problems that people worry about in this sector will be reduced quite dramatically. So I think, you know, you have to see the debate about switching sites and the failures of the market in that wider policy context. If you don't, I'm afraid you're missing a big part of the picture.
Absolutely. No, I think some of that's absolutely well made. I'll refer you to three policy exchange reports we've picked up. One being a report we published in November called Power 2.0, which talks about all the smart power stuff. One called Too Hot to Handle, which talks about how to decarbonise heat, which we put out in September last year. And one in January 2015 called Warmer Homes, which talks about the fuel poverty stuff, which I obviously don't have time to go through. But you can find copies of some of them on your way up. We've got probably time for two more questions. Let's have the lady in the second row here, and then drop the raise back.
Hi, Rebecca Yates from Smart Energy GB. We do the consumer engagement campaign around the smart meter rollout. Interestingly, one of the things that we find is when people have smart meters, they have better confidence in what they're using, and also say that they feel they've got more information to shop around for the best deal. I just wondered what the panel's thoughts were on the potential time of use tariffs and how that was going to affect how people shop around in the energy market, because we might end up having more metrics around, rather than just price, about lifestyle and things like that. So I wondered what the views on that were.
And if you take the question on the fourth row.
I'm Mark Casley from WA Comms. Will made a point that what we have at the moment is a lot of people propping up savings of a very small number of people. So if we have £300 savings when we've got a couple of million people switching, what will be the savings number if we have 25 million households switching? And would it be worth bothering to do?
Great. Those are both really good questions. I think time of use tariff, all that stuff is very interesting, and we talked a lot in the Power 2.0 report we did about some of this and how demand response is a real thing already, particularly with industrial and commercial clients who are doing that and responding to price signals. I think my sense is on the domestic front, there's less potential there simply because people are less able to flex their demand meaningfully. I mean, they may be able to, or once they've got a battery and so on, if they want to go and spend £3,000 on a battery. But for the time being, I think there is a limit to people's ability. If I look at the extent to which I can shift, I might set my dishwasher or washing machine to go at a different time, but I fundamentally need the lights on when I need the lights on, and I need to turn the cooker on when I need to turn the cooker on. So I think there's clearly potential there, but I think we need to be realistic about how much people are going to shift around. So that's my opinion. I think on the second question, yeah, I think there's a... People often sort of miss this one in that, you've got these two prices that are very far apart, and if we actually started to get lots of people switching, those prices would fold in on each other. People often miss that and assume that, everyone would come down to that lowest price, which is simply not possible. So it is a case that the many are propping up the few who are getting the good deal. So if we all switched a lot more, that would start to be less the case. I mean, that is just the maths of it. I suspect we'll never get to that point because people just won't ever switch quite that much. But interesting. Any other views on either question?
On the smart meter point, I think that the time of use thing with half-hour settlements, which the government in its recent call for evidence on a flexible smart energy system really pushed, and Ofgem is pushing that, I'm delighted to say. I think it will be have a greater take-up than you think, which is partly because it'll be automated. It's not that Granny Smith is going to say, I've got to not wash my clothes now because I've just looked at the wholesale market and it's a bit cheaper in 2 hours' time. That's not going to happen, right? It'll be more automated than that, and consumers will be assisted along the route, I suspect. And I certainly know companies who are thinking about that and ready for that.
Yeah.
I think the other two things about smart meters which should fold into this debate is, first of all, the Secretary of State, I pushed and we got agreement from the in the rollout plans that the prepayment meters would come early on in the rollout, because some of the bigger benefits for the fuel pool will come through smart meters that for prepayment. And so hopefully that will bring forward that and again reduce some of the issues. But the real thing I got quite excited with when I understood it at long last was that smart meters will enable 24-hour switching. And I know that there is a contestable argument about whether the length of time is a problem for switching, but I think for some people it is. It was interesting when we started off on this, we got the industry around the table, and they said, it's 5-6 weeks, it's very difficult to get it below 5 or 6 weeks. Very, very difficult, Mr. So, okay, let's have a flowchart of the time it takes and all the different actions. We got it down to 2 weeks and 4 days in about 2 hours, quite tricky. But it was quite clear there were two other barriers. One was technology, which was smart meters, and the other was consumer protection issues, which are serious ones. But you can get switching a lot quicker, and smart meters will push that, and that will have a big impact on the sector.
No.
I was going to say about smart meters, I think time of use tariffs is going to give rise to a different breed of supplier, but also a different breed of intermediary. So one of the first points I tried to make today was the fact that price comparison websites rule energy, as they do in many ways. just shows that suppliers haven't got beyond price as a differentiator. If suppliers can get hold of your time of use data, then they can offer a far better service and a service that might set them apart from the next guy. So when you see them charging 100 quid more for the first time, that might be justified. Different kind of supplier. Different kind of intermediary, because if you can engage constantly, people can't be bothered to engage once a year. So if you're looking to let someone do it for you, that's a question of delegation. And that's, you know, rather than checking in once a year, having someone do it for you constantly without as much oversight yourself, that's a different kind of intermediary. So I think it's quite exciting from our point of view, and also from every supplier out there. I mean, Ova are kind of leading the charge already, but I think it's a very, very interesting opportunity to get beyond an industry that can just be reduced to a simple price table.
I was going to say, on time of use tariff, it's an area that's got a massive amount of potential, but it all depends on how it's done. We have a saying in Citizens Advice, is sort of, you want a market that works for consumers, not a market that makes consumers work. And I think within the energy market, that's really important, because look where we are with switching. People aren't interested in engaging this market. So, and I think with this, is sort of, we would really urge suppliers to be cautious with what they're about, and just sort of, you know, if you're going to launch these tariffs, have additional protections built in. So if people find they switch onto these tariffs and it isn't working for them, let them switch off without a penalty, because that's the way you're going to build a long-term market that draws in more people, because it will be done the right way. You bring them along with you. So I think that's really something really important to think about.
Yeah, I was just going to pick up on Ed's point as well, in terms of the period of time that it takes to switch. Like you say, like the industry said, no, we can't do this, but actually with time we can get to it. And time is an important thing, because the longer that the switching process takes, the perception from a consumer perspective is there's a whole load of things that can go wrong. And why has this not happened, or where are we up to? And this sense of, I need to start to intervene, which kind of drives the perception that it's not been a great experience. And I have to say, on from the current account experience of 7 days, this is what it is, these are all the things we're going to take over, just provide that clarity for consumers. I think anything that does make it faster, but kind of very clear that this is how long it's going to take you, and an industry standard, because I'm sure the guys from the banking industry will say that took some, you know, a lot of negotiation with the industry players too.
If I could just offer one brief observation on smart meters. I think smart meters and all the stuff we're hearing about faster switching, all this kind of stuff, all of these actually have the potential to have real transformational benefits in the energy market, particularly for competition, if done well. They do present a major challenge for switching sites to keep up with that evolution as we get there. And it will breed new types of intermediary, and it will demand new ways of overseeing switching sites in a much more bigger sense. I've used the phrase traditional price comparison websites several times today. That's not going to be the model in a few years' time, assuming the smart meter rollout actually happens. That's a separate point. But assuming that all happens, there are going to be a huge number of different challenges, and I absolutely agree that consumers need to be brought along that journey with us. I think just looking at the CMA, a number of their remedies are all sunsetting when smart meters get to a certain level of rollout. So we have to think very seriously long term about what the next generation of switching service and market looks like.
Absolutely. That's probably a good place to end. So I'd just like to thank all of the speakers. I think it's been a really interesting debate. Thank you all for your contributions, and thank you to Citizens Advice and also UKR for sponsoring the event. We're actually doing one more round table on regulatory matters at some point soon, so if anyone's particularly keen to come along, if you give me your business card at the end, or just stick it on the table bit, then we'll try and get a few people along. But that will be looking at how regulation sort of copes with and encourages disruptive innovation, so that's one of the next things. I'll write this event up as a blog at some point when I get around to it, and we'll put the event hopefully sometime this week, because I think Cornwall Energy have asked for it. We've been videoing as well, so that will go on the website, if you want to see what anyone said in detail, chat back. But thank you all for coming along, and it's been a good discussion. Thanks.